IBM Spark Technology Center. And many of my team members are here. Basically, if you've not heard of the IBM Spark Technology Center, a bunch of really cool developers just focusing on curating Spark in open source, right? And working, that's pretty much our day job. So we're not affiliated with any products, but other products within the company consume us. But if you're interested in understanding what the STC does, check out spark.tc or come talk to me. I'll be hanging out with you. Okay? So anyway, welcome again. And I'll be giving it to Jared, who's part of Galvin.
Who here was here on Tuesday night for the two Spark talks? Raise your hand. Awesome, that's a pretty solid amount. I just want to thank IBM again, and I want to thank Chris for all the hard work he does in organizing this meetup, and thank them for the food and the wonderful drink. Let's give them a round of applause again. So who here is part of the SF Data Science meetup? Raise your hand. You probably get my emails on a monthly basis. My name is Jared, and I work at Galvanize. As some of you might know, Galvanize is an education company. We train data scientists. So on the third floor, we have over 100 data science and data engineering students who come in here every day to learn more data science and data engineering. And with that said, I'm going to turn it over to two of our faculty who just want to tell you a little bit more about those two programs.
Good evening, it's great to see you all. Thanks for coming to Galvanize. So I'd like to see a show of hands. Raise your hand if you already are a data scientist or a data engineer or systems engineer as a source of data. Who wants to be one of these people? Come on, I know there's no hand. Come on. Please, all right, get a little better. Warmer, all right. So, we offer several different programs here at Galvanize. One of them is, of course, our comprehensive six-month full-stack bootcamp, which takes people basically off the street. You have to have some intellectual talent, and we turn them into web programmers. Our other two educational programs include the 12-week intensive program in data science, which takes people that already have essentially degrees and backgrounds in some sort of data science and gets them tuned up and ready to win in interviews. For all the rest of you, perhaps you're a math major, perhaps you're a computer science major, perhaps you're a developer, but you want to get your skills tuned up and ready to compete with the PhDs and the master's degrees already in the market, we offer a one-year intensive master's degree program. A lot of people say, well, that's a lot of time to be out of the market. That's true, but it's not that much time, it turns out. Almost half of the program is spent in industrial internships. We teach a lot of advanced topics that you're not gonna get almost anywhere else, I'm pretty sure. Going up to advanced neural networks, probabilistic graphical models, and all sorts of data engineering. So our one-year master's program provides you the basic classwork to really compete with almost anybody in the field. On top of that, we have a lot of industrial partnerships. In fact, I just opened up a partnership with NASA. We have partnerships with IBM. So students who are interested in getting into a top-of-the-line job really have a great opportunity with us in the one-year master's program. If you have any questions about it, I would love to answer them. I am Dr. Jared Thompson. There's another one of our faculty up there, Brian Spearing. There he is, you can talk to him or near at any time, and we would love to talk to you about joining us at the master's program. And I'm gonna hand it off to Austin here, who's our data engineering professor.
Yeah, hi, so my name is Austin Elise, and I'm the lead instructor for data engineering immersive program that we have here. So the problem that you might have encountered for the people who raised up their hands and wanted to be data engineers is that, you know, there's a lot of stuff out there and you can look for example, if you want to set up a Spark or a Kafka or a Storm and all these technologies together, you can eventually figure it out because there's a lot of, everything is open source and there's a lot of documentations and examples and tutorials and blog posts and all kinds of other stuff out there. But after a while, you start it starts kind of wearing you down, because there's just, it's not the scarcity of information, but rather the abundance that becomes overwhelming. So the data engineering program kind of takes people with some background in development, and then through this 12-week immersive program, at the end of it, you kind of carve a path through all of these different technologies that are out there. And the program ends with a capstone project, which our first cohort just graduated graduating tomorrow. And they finished these projects a few weeks ago. So these projects have ranged from analyzing Twitter feed and just analyzing tweets on Twitter, as well as looking at jobs and doing natural language processing on them, and essentially building up these applications on the cloud that can consume and then process and analyze large amounts of data. So if that's something that you're interested in, talk to me afterwards, or just talk to Nir as well here, or any of the other galvanized people. So thank you so much for being here, and I'm going to hand this over back to Jared.
Thanks again for being here tonight, everybody. And this is the reason why we're really here tonight. Chris, let's give Chris a round of applause. Thank you. Okay, guys. So thanks so much, Galvanize. I think we've had enough introductions. We're going to get right into it. But we started off with about 200 or 300 people that first RSVP'd to me talking. And then, yeah, Martin signed up, and we got 700 or something. So, yeah, thank you, Martin, for that. All the way from Switzerland, right? Oh, yes, I have a funny story, actually, about Martin. I had seen him speak maybe 3 years ago or 2 years ago over at Intel in the Presidio. And I brought a Scala book, and I was super nervous, I had, a Sharpie and everything. And I realized I hadn't even opened this book. I didn't know Scala, and I felt like a poser. So I just walked away and didn't. But I've since learned Scala. And yeah, we have a son, Jakob, who got a cap suit. Yes, I have Jakob with the beer in your hand. Yes, are you old enough? Okay. All right. So the way that this is going to work is Martin's going to speak for about an hour, 45 minutes, take some questions. There's a lot of people here, so there's probably going to be a lot of questions. We'll have to cap it at some point. And then I'm going to speak for about 30 minutes or something. But yeah, let's get going.
Thank you. Thanks. Thanks for the intro, Chris. And I have a question. Why did you make this photo with the bird of me?
Oh, the bird. Yes, I liked your response, too. Yes, I tried to find a picture of Martin in college. I don't know, just Googled around. What was your response? It was pretty funny, but you sent me an email back.
I suspected that. I don't know how many of you know this blog post where they said every successful programming language was designed by somebody who had a very full beard. Thompson and Ritchie and Strauss-Stroop, and everybody had a beard, and those who didn't have a beard, their languages were less successful. So, so in the interest of the success of Scala, I should grow a beard, I guess. But yeah.
I was so scared he was going to either punch me in the face or
Good. So, what I want to talk about is Scala in 2016, because we're not a month into the new year, so I'm going to tell you a little bit of what I see happening in 2016, what I expect to in new developments in this coming year. But before we do that, let's have a quick look at 2015. It was actually pretty much on the quiet side in terms of new developments, new releases. There wasn't that much. There was solid growth in both jobs and all the other trends. So here you see indeed job trends, and here you see the Google trends for the search term Scala tutorial. What I like about that is this sort of very quiet progression. So I think Scala is way beyond the hype phase that was maybe up here in 2009, 2010. We're way past that, but we just essentially we see steady, not super exciting, but steady progress, and I think that's what I like to see. In 2016, things will move. Again, there will be a lot more new developments in 2015. The first one is the Scala 2.12 release. Then the beyond 2.12, we're going to rethink the Scala libraries. We're going to look at new target platforms. And then there is the sort of more experimental and far out work on DOT and DOTY. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about each of these things. Scala 2.12 is going to come out mid this year, so June timeframe, something like that. The most important thing for Scala 2.12 is that it is optimized for Java 8. So it uses Java 8's lambdas and default methods to get essentially more compact code that essentially doesn't have to create a lot of anonymous classes that can represent Scala functions directly. And the default methods are used essentially to have much more efficient encodings of Scala traits. So in that sense, Java 8 is really an excellent target for Java because essentially they finally have the primitives that we wanted for a long, long time to make Scala code not just run fast, but also be more compact, need less code, more compact jar size. In case you're still on, so this release 2.12 will only run on Java 8 because it makes use of all the new Java 8 features. If you're still on Java 6 or 7, then you can use Scala 2.11 for a while longer and it will be maintained for a while longer. That's also the reason why Scala 2.12 is intentionally very, very conservative in language features. We didn't want to have a large divergence between 2.12 and 2.11 because we know we have to support the two for quite a while in parallel because, I mean, not everybody is on Java 8 already. So that's why essentially 2.12 was intentionally very conservative and we think that things will speed up again for the releases after 2.12. So what will come after 2.12? Well, 2.13, obviously, and that one will focus mostly on the libraries. So where 2.12 was essentially a compiler release, essentially we have a better compiler, more optimizing compiler for Java 8. 2.13, we want to look at the libraries. There are plans to revamp the collections libraries so that it's simpler to use and for the data scientists among you, also to bring it more in line with the Spark usage. So there are several things that we can do to make Scala collections more like Spark collections. Spark collections, of course, were inspired from Scala collections. That's why they look so similar. I mean, you have the same operations, map, flat map, fold, all these things. But Spark also did several innovations which are worth taking back into Scala, and most notably the part around pair RDDs, so essentially collections with pairs merit to be supported better. In baseline Scala, currently what you would use is a map instead, but it's actually this sort of fluidity that you can say you have a sequence of pairs and you can treat it as if it was a map is very, very nice. Needs to shorter code and nicer code, and we would like to get that back into Scala. The other thing that we want to do to bring it closer in line with Spark is that we want to revamp our lazy collections, the views. So there's a big philosophical difference between Spark and Scala in that Spark collections are lazy. That means you build up essentially a computation and then finally you execute it, whereas Scala collections are by default strict. So if you execute a single map, then you get a new collection. There are good reasons for this difference, but what we want to do is essentially provide a way for Scala collections to be just as lazy as Spark, and that's called views. Views exist in current Scala, so it's not in principle a new concept, but current views are in the details both inefficient and sometimes surprising. So I think it's time for a complete redesign to have essentially a sane implementation of these views. Okay, the other thing that we are going to look at, and that's more speculative, is better modularization. So one option that we are currently considering is to have a split of the current standard library for Scala into something which is smaller, the Scala core, which is essentially there only to be big enough to support the Scala compiler and essentially the core Scala tools, and then something that is actually bigger than the current standard library, the Scala platform, which also would then be more essentially a collection of community supplied libraries. That way we essentially avoid the tension that we have right now, that our standard library is already quite big, but it's not actually big enough for many people, and the fact that it is big makes it hard to maintain. So we want to have essentially a more distributed maintenance of this thing, that several parties would essentially contribute modules in the Scala platform, and the core compiler people could concentrate on the Scala core, which is really sort of the thing that is essential for everything. That's something that we haven't decided yet, but we're currently considering, and that's sort of something where we need your input, both as an opinion, is this something that would interest you, and also as volunteers and contributors to say, well, I have this thing and I really would like to have this in the Scala platform if the Scala platform comes to be. So that was sort of our plans, where we want to start work once 2.12 is released, middle of the year, to think about, well, to implement these things. And of course, we would like to think about it right now, because there's a lag time, and you should think about these things thoroughly before you start to make the first steps implementing them. The next thing that will happen, or already has happened in 2016, is new platforms, new releases. The first one is my ever favorite Scala.js. So there's a new release just out, 0.66, which is the first release for 5 months. It has some very useful features, in particular support for JUnit, faster linking, and also a shiny new website. The other thing, which is far less far along, but nevertheless, maybe even more exciting, is Scala on LLVM. That's currently the work of Dennis Chabalin at EPFL. He's done quite good progress at getting an LLVM backend out there, but there remain a lot of things still to be done. So Scala LLVM right now is sort of an idea. Work has started on it, and it's something that really would, where we are looking for community contributions, that we say, well, let's get together and make Scala a language that exists on not just essentially a managed runtime like JVM and JavaScript, but really on the bare metal. That would be really interesting for a number of reasons. Okay, after those two things, let me go and jump to theory. So that's Dot. Dot is something that I'm personally very excited about, because it means that we finally have a proven foundation of Scala. What does it mean? Well, it's a calculus. That means essentially a condensation, an essence, a mathematical essence of what the language is. A minimal language subset that's chosen so that we can make formal statements about it and prove them using mechanized proofs, and also that we can encode much of the rest of the language in it. So it's sort of the essence of what we think Scala is, and it also serves as a great guide in developing the language further. So it opens the door to language work with a much better confidence that we're doing the right thing, that we're on the right path as before. So I wanted to show you a little bit what such a calculus looks like, because I guess not everybody here in this audience is a type theorist, so I'm going to translate it a little bit to what it looks like in programming language terms. So translated to Scala, the language we cover in this calculus is very, very small. So basically, it's this thing here. So what we see here is we have terms, so that's the expressions we deal with, and they are values, or variables, or function applications of a single parameter only, or selections, so essentially method selections, or local definitions. That's all we have. And for values, we have function values, so lambdas, so those you know, and we have object creations, which happen all to be anonymous functions. So at the moment, we don't even have classes in this thing, just a creation of an object with an anonymous class. And the definitions in an object, they can be method definitions, which don't even have parameters, just they're all parameterless, or the type definitions. So that's what we're looking at here. The types, I haven't shown you the types yet. So that's what the types would look like. Oops. So here we have our friend any or nothing. So you know those, the top type and the bottom type. Then we have type selection. So type selection could be something like scala.collection.immutableList, for instance. So essentially that could be the classes, but also the so-called path-dependent types. Then we have function types. We have very, very small records consisting of a single element, namely method declaration or type declaration. We have intersection, so that's what we currently would write with a with when we put two types together. And we have recursion, which we don't have directly in the language, but we have indirectly basically in the class system. So that's what we study. And what can we prove about that? So what we have shown with a proof that itself essentially is checked by a computer, so we know that the proof is correct, is this statement here. The statement says, if a term, an expression, has a type T, and the evaluation of the term terminates, so it gives you some final value, well, some final thing, then the thing you will get is a value. So value is one of these syntactic categories that you see here. One of these, so it's a well-formed answer. You could say it's not something silly. And furthermore, that value is of the same type T. So in a sense, that tells you that well-typed programs don't go wrong. They give you a value, and the type of a program is the type of the answer that you see. They are both essentially things that you would expect from a type system. So that's sort of the standard theorem that you always have or want for a type sound language, for a type sound system. And because these proofs are very, very involved, the standard nowadays where to really believe that the proof is true is that you want to have the proof itself checked by a computer. So we have an interactive theorem provers that we used for that called COG. That's a very popular theorem prover in that community developed in France. And with that, we have shown this property. So why is it important? Well, what's important about it is that now that we know what kind of things are correct and why, because we know the proof and we have checked the proof, it gives us an excellent guideline to reason about the correctness of other language features. By analogy, we know that in this mini language, this and this thing is correct because of these and these reasons. Now, if we add something to the language, we can say, well, does it invalidate any of the argument for the base calculus? If not, then, well, we could prove it formally, or we could prove it by an encoding, or we could just say, well, we have pretty good confidence that doing this is correct and doing this other thing is rather fishy. So I think we are on a much better basis now to evaluate what we have for the full language and also to go forward with it. So as part of the program to put this into practice, I want to talk about Dottie. So Dottie is the working name for a new Scala compiler I've been working on for, I think, about 3 years already now. It builds on DOT in its internal data structure, so you will see essentially everything that you saw in DOT as part of the compiler, and a lot of the language that the compiler parses and reads is afterwards desugared, we say reduced to these internal data structures so that we can be pretty sure that what we do there is correct. In particular, the big chunk of generics, so all the type parameters that you have in Scala, they are actually all mapped to these type members, so these records with the type fields. And that compiler supports an evolution of the Scala programming language, and we expect the first alpha release also this year. But that release is by far not the same as Scala 2.12. That's really strictly targeted at contributors and experimenters. So it will have rough edges, the error messages will be not so great, it might crash and all these things. It's really something to essentially try out and maybe get people to involved in pushing this further. But basically, the technical data are already pretty good. So here, I just give you two numbers. In terms of the size, so it covers essentially full Scala, or a variant of full Scala. It's 45,000 lines of code, which is pretty reasonable for a compiler that size. So just to compare, the current Scala compiler, NSC, is about 75,000 lines of code. And it's currently about twice the speed of NSC. So it's clearly faster, which is, of course, very welcome, in particular because we didn't really try to make it fast yet. There's a lot of instrumentation code left in the Dotty compiler, which we just have to remove to get probably another factor of maybe 2 or something like that. So I haven't tried that out, but I think the hope is that we will really get a compiler that improves compile speed fundamentally. So the Dotty architecture that we have here is shown in this diagram. So here we have on the left essentially what we do with Dotty, and on the right what we do with NSC, the current Scala compiler, and it's pretty similar. So both take Scala sources, not exactly the same Scala sources, I get to that. Then we have an internal AST, which is pretty much the same, but a lot cleaned up here. In particular, it's a lot more functional. Then we have transforms. There are many more here than here. But here we have, how many transforms do we have in the current Scala C compiler, Adrian?
5 or 6.
5 or 6, and here we have about 50. So it's a lot more, but these transforms, they're actually essentially fused together by a technique, so we essentially they don't take up a lot of space and they're very, very fast. Then in both cases we have a simplified AST, and then we go essentially into the code generator, which is actually shared between both compilers. That's called GenBcode. One thing that's different is that the new compiler uses an interchange format called Tasty, about which I've talked last year. Tasty is essentially typed abstract syntax trees, and it gives you a complete faithful representation of your whole program in a very, very compact format. So that opens the door to a lot of analysis and optimization tools, and we're working on some of those. So in particular, we're working on a linker, which is a whole program optimizer, which essentially takes these trees and produces highly optimized code, where essentially you drop everything you don't need, you inline everything you can, and so on. The current Scala compiler NSC doesn't do that, so it just essentially has a so-called pickled information for just the APIs that you need for separate compilation. That pickled format can also be read by the new compiler, and that assures that the thing is interoperable. So the new compiler can actually work in an environment where the files originally are produced by the current Scala C compiler, NSC, and you can add gradually, incrementally, the new Dotty files. Okay, so I said the language is not exactly the same, so there's some differences, and I'm going to explain just with 3 examples what they are. In the language evolution, the overall goal that we have is make the language simpler to use and improve the safety guarantees while reducing, at the same time, boilerplate. So I'm going to show you 3 new features supported by Dotty and 3 things that we take away in return. So the first feature that we have added is trait parameters. So here you see a simple example. You have a trait logging, and you see here it has a parameter. So currently you can't pass you can't have a parameter for a trait. Only classes can have parameters. This trait has a parameter, and it's essentially a log file. It wants to do logging, and during its initialization it says, well, open the log file, on program exit, close the log file, and here's my log method where I just write to the log file. And then I can use that from a class C, say, I just extend the logging trait with essentially a new file with my log data. Okay, what did we remove in turn? Well, we removed the way you would have gone about now doing the same thing, using something called early definitions. Who knows what early definitions are? Okay, a couple, yeah, but I think 95% of you don't know what they are, and it's true that they are a pretty esoteric feature of current Scala. So let me explain to you just for the last time maybe what they are, and afterwards they will go away. So what they are is that we say, well, if a trait doesn't have a parameter, then what can you do? The only way you can simulate parameters is by having an abstract field, like valf file, and that means file needs to be filled in by the implementing class. And then I can do the same thing with that file. Now when I extend the trait logging, I couldn't have written c extends logging and then valf equals new file. Why not? Well, because the logging trait gets initialized before I define this value f in the class. So it means initialization of the logging trait says f.open, and f will be null at this point. It won't yet be initialized. So in order to avoid that, we have in current Scala syntax like this, where we say class c extends, and then we have the curly braces, which say valf equals new file log, and then with logging. I guess but some of you have already seen code like that, most of you haven't. So the purpose of that was to say, well, we want to execute this thing before the initialization of trait logging and not after. So it achieves the same purpose, but in a very roundabout way. So but we now say, well, why essentially do all these things? And 95% of you don't know this feature, whereas trait parameters are the obvious simple way to do the same thing, and they make it then the whole system much more regular. So there's a net win in both simplicity and, I believe, usability for the language here. The other thing that it gives you is a more direct answer to whether you should be using traits or classes. So in the future, I think the answer is pretty much this one here, the rule of thumb. When something is fully defined, so you can create it with a new, make it a class. If it's still abstract, so if it's not fully defined, there are methods missing, then make it a trait. So the one thing that is sort of between a class and a trait, an abstract class, that's now less and less important. So I would say use an abstract class for Java interop, because Java wants to see an abstract class. So let's construct one. And maybe if you're really desperate for utmost optimization, then yes, it's true that on a lot of VMs, virtual dispatch for classes is still faster than dispatch for interfaces and traits. I'm not sure whether that's actually true for Java 8 anymore. It was true for Java 6 or 7. So there might still be reasons to say, well, maybe classes still have the performance edge. But it's probably going away soon. Okay, so that was the first addition, trait parameters for early definitions. The next addition is intersection types. And that's sort of, you could say that's almost cosmetic. So in the future, we write A and B for an intersection of A and B. So that type has as values all values that are both an A and a B. And it's almost the same as the compound type we had so far, the A with B. So you could ask, well, what's the difference between A with B and A and B? So in previous Scala, we essentially didn't make a distinction between inheritance. We used the with and essentially intersection of types, that we say it's an A and a B. And that's actually a good reason to make a distinction between the two. I'll show you why. So here's an example program, and you tell me what the types here are. So the program is this. We have a trait A, and it has a definition F of type A. And a trait B, and it has, a definition F of type B. And then we have two values, an AB and a BA, and AB is of type A and B, and BA is of type B and A. So what I want to know is what's the type of AB.F and BA.F. Well, you don't know intersection types, I've just introduced them, so I have to tell you. We afterwards do the same exercise with compound types, so then I will ask you. So for intersection types, the answer is AB.F has type A and B. So you get both definitions and you just form the intersections again. BA.F has type A and B. I could as well have said B and A, so it wouldn't have mattered because in that type system, A and B is the same as B and A. In other words, intersection is commutative. It doesn't really matter in what order you write the types. So let's redo the exercise with compound types and with types. So now I write the same setup, but A with B and B with A. What's the type of AB.F? Who knows? AB.F, what would the type be? No? Everybody, pull out the REPL, try it out. Yes?
I think it's B.
You got the answer of B, which is correct. Yeah, it's a B. Yeah. Good. It's a B. Why? Well, because essentially it looks up the types right to left. So it looks in first in B and says, okay, I found an F, it's a B. I won't search any further. That's the answer I get. But then, of course, it follows that if I look at BA.F, well, it looks in the A first. It says, okay, I found an F of type A. I won't look any further. So now the F field in those two vowels has different types, and that means that A with B is not the same as B with A. That's a typo here. So AND is commutative, intersection is commutative, but the compound types with are not. And that's the reason why I think it's important to clean these things up, because these algebraic identities, they seem to be sort of just polishing and don't matter much, but believe me, when you build on them, they start to matter a lot. So it's very important to have a very clean theory on which you can build. So the other thing we added was union types. So union types are the dual of intersection types. An intersection type says values that are an A and a B. The values of A or B are all the values that are of A and all the values of B. So values that are of type A or of type B. So an example would be you could write string or list of int, and that would have as legal values either strings or list of ints. Union types are useful for what we call ad hoc open sums. So you could say, well, why use a union type? Shouldn't we have, let's say, a common base trait of that we could use then, that we say, well, my type A extends something and B extends something, and then it's a thing that everybody extends? If you can do that, if you have control over the source, yes, that's a very good strategy, and I think that's the right design. But if I have something like that, you don't have the choice. String and list of int do not share a common base class or base trait except any ref, and that's probably not good enough. So it's actually better in that case to be able to write, it's not on any ref, I don't erase all the types, but it's that or that. And it's open, and that means you can have arbitrary many operands, and that's a big advantage over more clunky solutions like using either. So you could, of course, use either now. It's either a left of string or a right of list of int, and that's also possible, but that's essentially less efficient because you create an additional object, and it's also more clunky. So the union types have this advantage. What did we take away for union types? Well, we didn't take away a construct, but we eliminated something which is actually more important. We eliminated the phenomenon of exploding lubs. So what's exploding lubs? So Scala's type inferencer often needs to compute the least upper bound of two or more types. So that means it's the least type that is a supertype of both of the types. For instance, in an if then else, it has, well, this thing has a type, it's a vector, this thing is a type, it's a list. So let's find the common supertype of vector and list. And in that case, it would be something like that. It would say, the Scala type checker would say, well, both of these things are a sequence, and both of these things are also an abstract sequence, and the two, neither of them is better than the other, so I have to take both of them. And they also happen to be serializable, so these three types are the least supertype of all of the two branches of the if. So that's what you would see in the wrapper. If you change that slightly, so instead of list, you just make this arrange. then you get something much, much bigger. So in fact, the REPL is decent enough not to bother you with the whole type, which goes over many pages. So it stops after a while. It just this thing. So that's unfortunate that the least common supertype of those two types was just very, very large. The compiler isn't wrong in these things. It computed the least common supertype, and that least common supertype happens to be very large. Why does it happen to be very large? So I tried to reformat this thing a little bit, and that tells you a little bit what goes on here. So essentially what goes on here, you see the same index seek abstract seek serializable, but then there's a common supertype custom parallelizable, and that sort of behaves differently. So both of them are ints, but then the second type is a parse sequence, and then it seems to repeat itself again. It says, well, this thing has a seq field, and that's again one of these things. So in fact, it turns out that the least common supertype, if you would compute it completely, would be infinite. And the compiler just truncates at some point, but in this point, it's not fast enough truncating. And that's why you see these messages. It's a very hard problem, which has really bothered us for many years with Scala, because essentially, it doesn't really have a good solution until union types. Because with union types, the whole thing has a very nice solution. You could say, if you write that, then the type you would expect is to say, well, I have a vector. I have a range. So I should get the union of the vector and the range, and that should be it. We don't have a dotty REPL yet, so I faked it, and now I was found out because I introduced a typo in this thing here. But that's what you would expect to see, a union of a vector and a range, and that's the union type is, of course, the least upper bound. So by essentially having a type for that, we avoid these problems with the very large or sometimes even infinite approximations. Okay, so who's working on all that? Well, Scala is very much community driven. There's not a big company that essentially pulls the strings and keeps everybody out. In fact, Scala relies on you, on people like you here, to contribute, to help. And what we want to do here is to put that in a better form. We are thinking of, and we are planning of creating a new entity for the stewardship of Scala. So we're about to create a Scala Center, which will act like a foundation. We don't like the admin overhead of a foundation, so that's why the center will be organized as an independent unit of EPFL, my home university in Switzerland, but it will act like a foundation. So the center has two missions. The first mission is organize open source projects around Scala, like the next Scala.js or the next modules in the next Scala platform, or maybe even contribute to essentially to these far out designs, the next Dotty, make Dotty really the next Scala compiler, things like that that essentially are more forward looking and than just essentially the maintenance of the current platform. The second mission of the Scala Center is to organize and develop online teaching. So we're working hard to reinstantiate our Scala courses on Coursera. It's been difficult because Coursera has changed their grading infrastructure, and we have essentially had to upgrade our graders, and that was harder than we thought, but we should be done very, very soon. And I think you can expect an announcement of the courses starting up at Coursera any week now. And what's more, we want to actually develop new courses as well, so it won't just be the course on functional programming. There will also be courses on parallel programming and also on using Spark in Scala. So that's the other mission that the Scala Center will have. If you want to, we need your help to do this, so it's very much a community effort. If you want to help us, please contact me after the talk. Thank you. I think we have time for questions.
Just make sure that you repeat the question.
Yes.
Yeah. Hi, I was just wondering how you'd recommend people really start to get involved in contributing to not just Scala, but programming languages as a whole. I mean, it's a very theory intensive work, and not everyone has the joy that you have to actually be able to do that from a 9-to-5 basis.
Okay, how do you contribute not just to Scala but to programming languages as a whole? What I can talk only more or less how we are organized, but I think how we are organized is not untypical. I think there are quite a few languages that have a similar organization. So what I would recommend is to get involved initially in the bug tracker on Jira. There's a Gitter channel for discussions, and essentially just look at what's outstanding. Are there some easy things to fix? Things that are usually easy is, in particular for newcomers, you come and say, well, I really found this documentation confusing, and I think I can do a better job writing this thing up. And as for all open source projects, we are shorthanded on documentation. So help on documentation is definitely great and very, very welcome. And it could be the first step to say, well, now I know how it's supposed to work. I have a look at the code, and maybe I find some bugs where I can actually fix the thing and move it along. And like that, you can branch out then to more and more advanced things. That would be my recommendation. Okay. Other questions? Oh, okay.
How strong is your commitment for backwards compatibility?
How strong is my commitment for backwards compatibility? So I think what you've seen in the last 5 years, that this commitment was very, very strong. So I think we have seen that every version has taken backwards compatibility more seriously than the one before. Particularly, there are now some hard guarantees, like minor releases will be forwards and backwards binary compatible. Sorry, and major releases will be very careful. There's a tension in that it means that if you take this very seriously, then you can't innovate a lot, and maybe you can't even fix some bugs because they would violate some backwards compatibility. So I've been trying to find a way out, so to speak, and I've talked last year about Tasty, where I think Tasty would be a technical solution for that, because it would essentially represent the Scala platform, map the Scala platform on a higher level, where you wouldn't be tied to, let's say, low-level backwards compatibility concerns on the JVM binaries. We could recompile dynamically if we need to. So far, that's still in the future, but that's something that I definitely want to do. In terms of backwards compatibility, what I foresee, I'm not quite sure, but I would say it's probably the most likely course, is essentially to have a big jump. So we will keep the 2.x series of things going on for quite a while, and they will take backwards compatibility very, very seriously. But for Dottie, as I've shown you, there are actually language changes where essentially what we would do is we would say, well, we will do these language changes. We will try to soften the blow, so to speak, by having a source code migration tool, which won't be 100% perfect. I can already tell you that. Our goal is to say for typical Scala code, would maybe one manual intervention for 1,000 lines is still acceptable. So that's sort of my bar. Of course, that begs the question, what is typical Scala code? And then we could talk all night about that one. Yeah. Yeah?
So are you anticipating a faster compile times with the next release, or is it, you see the bigger jump with your new design you discussed tonight, the version after? And second question, Is this symptomatic of the implied type system that
yeah.
Scala or other languages in the class?
Okay, so the question was, are we anticipating a speed improvements for the next release, or is it really this new compiler design? I don't know, and I'm not sure Adrian knows either, because we must admit that compile time speed is a big, big mystery for all of us. Everybody has looked into it, and we're all mystified, essentially, what really costs it. So we have, there's some reasons why it's inherently hard. The first thing that it's inherently hard, the first thing I should say is it very much depends on the kind of program you're writing. If you write a program in a more object-oriented style, not using too many types, 500, 600 lines a second out of that, on the new compiler about twice that, and in the future probably we will go up to 2,000 lines a second or something like that, which is still not as fast as Java, but it's decent. The next thing is, of course, since Scala code is a lot more compact, it does a lot more. And you won't get that for free, because what the compiler does, in effect, is expand the compact Scala code to a much bigger Java code. And it has to compile that again, right? So essentially, a shorter code will not translate into shorter compile times, because internally the compiler has to expand it to the bigger thing, and the class files are just as big, if not bigger, as Java's. The third thing is that for my project, I find that if I use an IDE or a continuous compilation with SPT, I use incremental compilation, then it's generally pretty good, actually. I don't tend to wait for the compiler. So I think with all these things, that's sort of the picture. But the tantalizing thing is, if you ask the people, well, where actually is the time spent and how could we make the compiler 20% faster, nobody would know. People have tried, believe me. I mean, I know one big bank who essentially had a whole team of college students, and they said, your project is make this Scala compiler faster. They came back and they got 0.0%. Yes?
For dynamically compiling Scala code, I think there's one option where you mention Scala like interpreter, you feed the code and or you can actually use the quasi-code mechanism, right? So what is your recommendation?
I didn't quite, so is that for dynamic compilation of code?
Dynamically compiling code.
Yes.
Right? So you can pass in a string, right?
And yes.
The string is Scala code.
Yes.
And then basically use a Scala.
Use the compiler on the string, yeah.
Yeah. So one way, another way is you do the quasi-code way, right?
You use the oh, the quasi quotes. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. Well, the quasi quote way is in a sense both more efficient and safer than starting the compiler up on a string. So I would recommend to do it the quasi quote way. Yeah. I don't know. That maybe you can try it out. I don't know. Yeah. I would suspect quasi quotes are faster. Yeah.
Faster? Okay.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Yeah. Yes.
Can you use tasty for reflection?
Can you use tasty for reflection?
Or how is reflection in the compiler like?
So yeah, I think that should be possible. Well, it's a reflection of the compiled code, so you want to introspect the code, that which is a form of reflection. And I think tasty is very good for that. Tasty is not something where you can say, well, I have these runtime structures and runtime values, and then I want to look into that. You need to essentially use something else, mirror-based reflection or something like that. So tasty doesn't do that. Tasty says, well, I have these methods and these classes in my thing, and inside these methods I have this code, and I can explore it into every statement and every expression, which is, for some tasks, that's what you need, not for all of the tasks. Yeah.
So, does Scala support a method like overloading, where it's the same method name, right? So, and then the argument say could be a different type.
Yeah.
So it seems like I tried in the Scala shell, certain things that work, but then for some other kind of complicated types, it seem to have this erasure problem.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Okay. That's right. So the question was, does Scala support overloading? Yes, it does support overloading. Then the observation was, well, sometimes it doesn't work because of erasure, which is also true. So what happens in Scala, and also Java, I should say, is that erasure essentially maps the high-level Scala types to the low-level JVM types. And the JVM also gives you overloaded methods, but of course they must be different. They must have different types on the JVM. Otherwise they wouldn't be overloaded. It would be essentially two definitions of the same method. And sometimes erasure gives you two high-level types that look different, but they map into the same JVM types, and then essentially you get a compiler error which says, well, essentially these two things have the same erasure and that's illegal. There are workarounds for that. So one typical workaround for that, it's not beautiful, but it works, is to just give one of them an implicit parameter or something like that you can always pass. It just has a new type, because that parameter will be part of the erasure, and that way you can disambiguate. So if you hit that problem, that's what people typically do. Or, I should say, overloading is one of these things where you say, well, it's pretty useful when used in moderation, but it also gets abused a lot, that you just have too many versions, and maybe you should think about to say, well, maybe use different names, something like that, if that happens. So I think overloading is something that is more often overdone than not in code bases. Yeah, dummy parameter. And with Scala's implicit, you don't even need to pass a dummy argument for it. It will be passed automatically if you choose it right. Yes?
Did you mention the dotting colors with 2.13, or is it further out?
Sorry, the dotting. No, dotting is further out than 2.13. 2.13 will be the Scala 2 code base. And revamped libraries, in particular new collection libraries, and possibly a split into core and platform of the Scala standard library. That's the plan for 2.13. Yeah.
Can you think about any kind of direct impact on how Spark will improve on any change in Scala that will happen this year?
Sorry, I didn't catch it acoustically.
Yeah, basically, is there anything new that will come in Scala this year that will directly impact Spark?
Okay, is there anything new that will come from Scala that will directly impact Spark? Well, there are a lot of people on the Spark team, so they're probably better positioned than I to respond to that. I think Spark has the problem that Spark wants to run on 2.10, 2.11, and now at some point also 2.12. So they are naturally held back to use new features because they want to support old releases. In a sense, everybody has that problem. I mean, we for a long time couldn't support Java 8 because, well, we kind of needed to run on Java 6 and Java 7. So essentially, if you sit on top of something, then you always move slower than the thing you're sitting on because you have to support the old releases. It's just a matter of life. But I think, of course, eventually, I guess Spark will come around and make use of the features. That's for sure. The question is when. Unit types, yeah. Yes, you get a union of three, so you get A or B or C. You can have as many as you want here. Like intersection, I didn't point that out. Like intersection, it's commutative and associative, so you can, it's basically a set of possibilities. You can reorder them any way you like. Well, if there are no further questions, then thank you all for listening. Oh, we have one more. Okay.
Try to do numerical computing in Scala.
Yeah.
The problem is performance, like boxing kills okay. Performance. And do you think about this?
Yes, very good. That's actually a good question. Well, the others were good as well, sorry. That's a very good question. Thanks for asking. So the question was, numerical performance suffers sometimes because of boxing, and that's true. So there are several things going on that will help for that. So one is specialization. So specialization in Scala currently, oops, seem to have lost my mind. Okay. Specialization is very, very restricted, and it leads to code explosion right now. What we want to do currently in Dotty, we will see how much of that we can backport to the existing Scala, is a whole program analyzer called the Linker. And that will essentially do a much better job at specialization because it can essentially know what code paths your program will take. So for that, there's a lot of hope that we can do pretty significant improvements. The other thing that's on the horizon is Java 10, which will have value classes. And value classes also avoid the boxing and boxing overhead. So when Scala targets Java 10, again, we have solved the problem. For like this year, 2016, I don't really have an answer for you. So I'm sorry about that. OK. Yes, last question. Scala, will Scala achieve the same performance as C++? Well, it depends. So there are quite a few programs where Scala is actually faster than C++. You might say, well, I haven't heard of them. Well, actually, what he can do, and what people do, but right now it's more experimental and research, is use so-called staging to have very highly optimized parallel code that runs directly on the hardware. So Tungsten on Spark is essentially a Spark-specific project that does that. There are projects like that have been underway in Scala for a while, particular with the lab of Kulio Lokotun at Stanford University. We have done quite a few studies with very, very impressive benchmarks. So there are quite a few problems where Scala runs circles around C++ using that trick. That trick is currently not something that you probably want to use immediately in production, but you said one day, and so the answer is yes, probably. Yeah, I mean, we've shown it in the lab already. Okay. Thank you. Okay.
Hey. I represent the Scala community of Russia.
Ah, hey, no, hello.
So I have a mission to say hello from the community.
Okay, yeah.
And we've, 2 days ago, we did our first Scala meetup.
Oh.
Yeah, it's in Moscow.
Okay, yeah.
You guys are really engaged and excited and willing to contribute, so maybe you would be able to record a short video saying hello and inviting them to contribute.
Sure, I can do that,
yeah. Can I have a picture with you?
Yeah.
My name is Aaron from Uber.
Oh, hello.
We'd like to invite you to visit if you're interested. We have a large crowd of Scala practitioners.
Alright, so I guess a 10-minute break and then start up. So we'll get you guys out of here by 8:45 or so.
Did it power?
Turned on.
Yeah. Okay. That got a little break.
Yeah. Sweet. Yeah.
Yeah, so something's happening. Let's get started here, guys. Yes, like a lot of you know, my very first meetup here, we started with this fun thing, Spark After Dark. This was 6-7 months ago. Real quick. So that guy, Vijay, that spoke first, yeah, that's my boss back there. Yeah, he's waving. Yeah, he lets me do this sort of unwillingly, but I just keep doing it, so. But. Yeah, no, he fully supports all this stuff. This is why the meetup has grown so big so fast, and we're able to get really good content. Gives us time to research and find cool stuff. So today's talk, we're going to start with a live demo. I've been kind of building off of Spark After Dark just because it's a ridiculous name, and it's a fun little site. But if you guys can actually go to Spark After Dark right now, and this is totally anonymous. If you haven't seen this before, I changed it. This used to be actors and actresses when I was traveling through Europe. I realized that nobody knows these actresses and actors. So I switched over to what we all know, which is software. If you guys can click on the specific, just pick 4 or 5 of these tools that you actually use in production, right? And so what we're gonna do is I've got 4, so yeah, I can click on Spark, obviously. I should not click on Flink, but we have been looking at it. Kafka. So in the background here, I've got a Spark streaming job that's using Twitter Algebird's Count Min Sketch. So there's a data structure called Count Min Sketch. And I've got, actually I have 4 Spark streaming jobs running. So this is actually, I've been kind of proposing this as a sort of informal best practice, but right, like you don't have to jam everything into one Spark streaming job. Right, like a lot of people get really excited and build a small one and they start doing aggregations and then you know the batch window gets 5 seconds and then they start training models and you know that takes 20 minutes and their whole streaming like infrastructure gets all backed up. So. This is live, this is you guys selecting. We've got, so I'm tracking the top 5 heavy hitters, which is a Twitter term, obviously Twitter Algebird. These are people like Martin Odersky, right? People, so these are the top ones so far. We have Yarn, HDFS. Let me see if I can make this bigger. Oops. Yeah, Python's making a comeback there, that's good. Scala. Okay, so I've got these, yes, I have these multiple jobs running. I've got one that's pulling it off the stream, off Kafka. So when you guys are selecting these things, it's using the Kafka REST API from like Confluent and pushing it into Kafka, and then I have these 4 Spark streaming jobs listening on that same queue, right, the same Kafka topic. The Cassandra one is actually just taking that raw data, storing it into Cassandra. Yeah, we'll take a look at that in a second. I've got a Redis one keeping track of an exact count. So I've got Redis supports HyperLogLog, which is one of the other structures that we'll talk about here in a bit. And then Count Min Sketch, that's the one that's actually writing that out. So, let's see. Let's take another quick look. Okay, so it's pretty much the same ones here. Oh, yeah, JSON sneaked in there. All right. Yeah, that's unfortunate. Okay, so let's take a quick look. This would be the notebook here that's just going to call into Cassandra. So Cassandra, that's an exact count, right? It's doing a little magic here. This should be the same ones we saw. Looks like Python creeped back in. And then, yeah. So that is Cassandra, and then I've got the Redis HyperLogLog. Yes, all this is available off this, yes, I have this site called the AdvancedSpark.com. If you go to AdvancedSpark.com, all the demos and everything are here. It's a Docker image you can download and run all this stuff yourself. So I keep it up to date because if it's not up to date, it will break. But so here I just picked one item ID, Spark, it happens to be number 7, and that Redis, like HyperLogLog Spark streaming job, is pulling it down and then using HyperLogLog, and it's basically adding for each item, right, like how many people selected it, and it's a distinct count. That's what HyperLogLog does here. So let's go back. So this is the approximate number of distinct users who rated item ID, who selected item 7. This will be the exact 23. So yeah, see a little bit. Yeah, we're starting to see. Yes, I actually did some testing before, so let me pick a different one. Can't remember what number 1 is, but anyway, so yeah, the approximate number was 6. The exact number is number ratings for item. Oh yeah, the distinct is 5, right? Okay, yeah, so all this code's out there. I guess we can get right into the talk. So who here has used these approximation techniques, these probabilistic data structures? Yeah, so which ones? Yeah, you in the back. Yeah, just straight. Yeah, so I just want to do one slight disclaimer here. I'm a data engineer, and I'm surrounded by a lot of data scientists and people from the IBM Spark Tech Center and people from Galvanize. So my take on these things is how to use them and how they make my life better. Some of the math I've chosen to pull out, partially because I don't fully understand it, and partially because I don't want to bore you with a bunch of formulas. This is, I have to go down the middle of the group of people here. So anyway, let's get right into the presentation. Yes, how about Bloom filters? Got anyone actually implement a Bloom filter or use a Bloom filter?
Yeah.
Used pretty commonly. It's a pretty basic one to reason through. Okay, I guess at IBM, we're known for packing slides with tons of words, so I've started to fall victim to it. I try to redo the slides every now and then, but yeah, we're obviously hiring. I'm sort of the nice person, police patrol, so although I haven't really been able to exercise any kind of power or anything, but yeah, we try to hire nice people because we like to work with nice people. So this is the same slide I do if you guys have seen my talks before. Netflix, Databricks, currently at the IBM Spark Tech Center. I've got a book supposedly coming out, trying to work on that. I have this meetup. Yeah, we had 2,300 people. I think we're number 3 now or something, or as of today. And then 2,500 Docker image downloads. So I've had a lot of people. I'll push out something and break a script or whatever, and I have people starting to contribute. Picked up a committer a couple weeks ago, so starting to see traction. It's not really, I'm not gonna productionize this or anything, of course, but it's good to see other people catching these things and kind of keeping me in check. So this meetup's mission is to go deeper. Yeah, same thing I say every time. Try to pull out patterns from these big data projects and show them all integrated together too, and see that whole pipeline in action. Oh yeah, if anyone came to the last meetup, we had the 2000 cake, which I didn't get to have any, but yeah, everyone else ate it. Okay, so there's gonna be 5 big things that we'll cover, and I think you know, most of this is going to be filling in cracks for people's knowledge. So parallelism, composability, we'll talk a little bit about monoids, of course. We'll talk about when to approximate, when like not to approximate. We'll talk about some of these common algorithms and some of the intuition behind them. That's the stuff that I personally like to focus on versus some of the math details. And then, yeah, common libraries and tools. So we'll talk about Redis and Algebird. And then, yeah, probably finish up with a couple demos. So this is pretty well known, right? If you can do things in parallel, yeah, you get log n versus trying to add them all up. So yes, adding is yeah, obviously pretty big in the whole analytics world, right? That's what you're trying to do. So can you guys see this? Is it? Can we darken? Unfortunately, the background is dark. Any suggestions from yeah, the galvanized folks? Anyone? Shut up. Rafi. Just change the background. This is bad. Can I brighten it? Brightening is not. Yeah, can we dim these front lights? Invert the colors. Is that better? It's also kind of like off the screen a little bit too. But okay, so that shouldn't be a problem. So yeah, composability, this is what we're going for. Yeah, obviously multiply, add, union, these things are good. Max, min. Yeah, division, yeah, nobody likes division, right? This is not composable, things get kind of wonky. What were the Egyptians thinking back then? Yeah, they obviously weren't thinking of composability and scale. Okay, keep going. So how about average? Yeah, average is kind of an interesting one. Pairwise average is not good. You can't really mix those things, right? But you can. Keep one big count of all the values, one big count of all the counts. So there's, you know, an A coming in, two Bs, a C. You can do it that way, or you can keep the local average and then the counts, and then you can sum them up that way, right? So there's ways to kind of think about these things where you can turn them into parallelizable. All right, let's get to the next one. So when to approximate. When you're memory bound or time bound, right? So at Netflix, this would come up all the time. We would do a release that we wanted just an approximate count of errors that happened from the last hour to the current hour. We would run Hive queries, we would get the exact number, and it would take 45 minutes. The data pipeline was an hour and a half or something, so I was already 2 hours out of date by the time I even got the data. So I would basically just rely on my sister, who was living in like DC at the time, and when her kid, you know, couldn't watch Netflix, then yeah, that's when I would get calls. So I started to rely on her versus Hive. We got things, if you're using any kind of machine learning graph algorithms, these are inherently probabilistic, right, and approximate. So, right, like finding topics in like documents, trying to do like some sort of all pairs similarity where you have, you know, items, picture all the, right, like Netflix users trying to find similarities, yeah, page rank, things like that. If you're doing streaming, so if anyone tells you that Spark streaming now has exactly once, they're wrong, right? Because it's not, from their perspective, Spark streaming does, but the actual place where you're writing things out to, if you're writing to Cassandra or somewhere, that, like, there's no transactional aspect to that, right? So yeah, all these things are at least once, and that's the best you can do. Not unless, yeah, you're at a bank, you need to track pennies and that kind of stuff. So yeah, that's one of the reasons I moved from Chicago to California, was so I can go to media companies and not have to work at banks. So yeah, the means for collecting this data is just as sloppy to begin with. Basically, yeah, when to approximate, try to do it as much as you can, as much as the business people will let you, and then ask for forgiveness when, yeah, the numbers don't add up. When not to approximate. If you've ever heard, yeah, this term, Sarbanes-Oxley, Yeah, it has to be in that order though, right? If it was Oxley-Sarbanes, yeah, that's not the same thing, right? Yeah, at work after 2002, yeah, these guys are the ones that made me leave Chicago, not made me, but caused me to leave Chicago. Yeah, so don't approximate. A few good algorithms here. So common to most of these algorithms, we have fixed size. Yeah, so these are fixed size data structures, and you can tune them based on the error, right? So like you're balancing error with the size, and you could store large amounts of counts here. As compared to like a Java hash map or something like that, if you're trying to make, you know, you have like key value pairs, you're like, yeah, so trying to keep counts that way, yeah, that's not good. You're just gonna blow through RAM super fast. So let's see. Yeah, and then they typically also rely on these multiple hash functions. So we'll show one case where, so this particular hash function is, right, like uniform distribution, and there just aren't that many, right? So what you do is actually break the data set up into multiple sections and then use that same hash function. Yes, we'll talk about that in a sec. Also, the size of the hash range, so picture, right, like the like most common is like a BloomFilter. You get this piece of data, hash it, stick bits inside of a bit set. So yeah, the broader that range is, the more like memory that you give to that range, then your error goes down because there's less collisions. So bloom filters. Yeah, this is one where you're basically given two answers. If this key that you're looking for is in the set, it's gonna say this might be in the set. If it's definitely not in the set, it's gonna tell you definitely not. Yes, also this is unique in that you can't actually take out any values because once you start hashing and then like flipping these bits, things have to stay there. So let's take a look at this one. This is actually, I sort of shamelessly stole these from Avi Bryant, just for the sake of time, but essentially you take some key that comes in, right? Hash it multiple times, and wherever you end up, yeah, so flip that bit. So the problem here is that if you have multiple keys that happen to overlap, right? So now you'll like flip these bits. When you go to read them, there could be this sort of overestimate that this item is in there. But yeah, so that's why you would get the answer maybe. But if you don't get those bits, yes, once you hash it. So this is the write path, this is the get path, the retrieve path. And if you see all the bits flipped from those multiple hash functions, then it's a maybe, because there could be collisions from other hashes, yeah, from other values. Count min sketch. So this is for frequency counting, top K type stuff. The heavy hitters here. That's funny, I was actually in, I think it was Zurich, and I was sitting next to a guy at the bar, and it turns out it's this guy, Johnny Holiday, who apparently is like a huge like sensation. Anyone know this guy? He's like the like Elvis of France. Yeah, and yeah, so I thought he was just like the local crackhead or something. I had no idea who this guy was. And so I quickly found, yeah, so I was doing a meetup out there, and I found a story about his wife, and there was some huge blow up, right? Like, do you know about this? Have you been keeping up with Johnny? Huge thing, and she's divorcing him and tons of money. So, of course, yes, I had to work that into the meetup, and that was pretty not really that funny. But yeah, because people really like this guy. Yeah, Mark Odersky is a heavy hitter, right? This is the beard thing he was talking about. And then Donald Trump. Ugh. Yeah, this was going on when I was in Europe, and I was like, is this really happening? Like, is this like what like Europeans think of our political system? You know, am I being filtered here? All right, so this is count min sketch in action. We've got movies coming in. We've got people. So this is top K movies based on total views. So So we've got this movie coming in. This has been viewed. This is a typical like use case, like Netflix, of course. We get these like play events. Each movie, so this is Top Gun, gets hashed like multiple times again, and the output is basically, so each of these rows is one like hash function. Each of the columns is the like binary output for those hash functions. So again, so Top Gun comes in twice. This is just a little extra complexity that I threw in there to like try to confuse you guys. So this is, so there, it gets hashed to here, here, and here. And so because it's twice, there's 2, 2, 2. And then we've got A Few Good Men comes in. I picked all Tom Cruise movies for some reason. So this guy comes in, there's a conflict here, hashes to an overlapping cell from Top Gun, right? So again, there's a possibility to actually overestimate. So before we were overestimating 0 and 1, there could be 1, but it could be 0 as well. But we'll never underestimate. So 3, 1, 1. Taps, yes, anyone seen Taps? I think it was Tom Cruise's first movie. It was before Risky Business, I think. So Taps comes in, this guy gets hashed 3 times, boom, boom, boom. There's now overlap with A Few Good Men. So now on the read path, we're trying to figure out, so how many times has Top Gun been watched in an approximate way? So we use the same hash functions. We get to the same 3 cells where the original one was set, so here, here, and here. We take the minimum, right? Because we don't want to underestimate, but we could potentially have some like conflict there. So yeah, this is actually, yeah, so this one, yeah. So right, like this ends up actually being accurate because there were no other conflicts on that third one. Yeah, so the more hash functions that you use, you know, like the more accurate things will be. Find the minimum. You can overestimate, but never underestimate. Ah, yeah, I said no formulas, but this one snuck in. So, yeah, HyperLogLog. Yeah, so the one that we did before was top K and counts. Now, this is basically count distinct, right? So there's a small twist here. This is the one where the hash function that we use, the whole key to this algorithm is uniform distribution. So the output is gonna evenly hash, right? Like throughout this range. And so this is how you can estimate error. If you give it this range of, basically, if you give 14 bits for the size of the range, and then so 2 to the 14, so we have 16,000 slots essentially in this big right, like array. And then, yeah, so like that's how you can actually estimate the error. So this is, it can be up to 0.81%. So yeah, this is the trick, is that there's not many of these specific, of these special hash functions that can do this. So what you actually end up doing is taking subsets of the data and then, right, like, yes, using this same hash function on the different sets and then doing an average across those. And there's a way to do it with a harmonic mean, which is, so that's the HyperLogLog part. And then there's, what's the other one? Like geometric mean, which would just be log-log. So this is kind of a visual of the like even distribution here. So this is for a given movie. Yes, I want to know the number of distinct users. So this was, yeah, that's user something. What you can do now is, because we know that this is evenly distributed, what you could do is just kind of keep an eye on a smaller subset, right? So like you don't have to maintain this whole structure, but just keep an eye on these, because this is going to approximate. So I went to half just because I don't have a lot of data here. But, and then I purposely did, this is, broken up, so this is hour number 1, and it's broken up into 16 slots, and then this is hour 2, so maybe we're starting to get into the evening hours, right? People are watching more and more. And yeah, so, and then there's this third thing, right, like where you can actually combine these things. So, right, like you'll lose a little bit of precision, But yeah, you can actually take hour one, hour two, and then start to do rollups that way, right? Like approximate rollups. All right, so this one's really cool. This one came up quite a bit at like Databricks, actually. Like a lot of our customers were starting to use this. Yeah, that's actually from a whiteboard at Databricks, which I'll probably hear from them tomorrow about this. But yeah, this was one of their data scientists explaining like locality sensitive hashing to me. So essentially, what we're trying to do is find similar items, right? So picture movies, and yes, each movie has a genre, or like multiple genres, right? So what you can do is take the genre, that set, hash it, and what you're, oh, so yeah, this particular hash is, there's one pre-process step that you go through. So go through all the data once. Yeah, so let's say M is the, right, like the number of users, or right, like movies, I guess, yeah, this way. And then break it up into smaller buckets, right? So instead of doing Cartesian, because if you don't do this, what you're doing is comparing that first movie to the next, you know, 29,000 or whatever, and then second one to the other 29,000 and doing this huge Cartesian, like similarity comparison, which is just, that's the worst thing you can do. It's M squared, in this case, N squared. So you can pre-process, get these things approximately into the same buckets, and then, yeah, so they can get hashed into different buckets as well, so they're not all gonna end up in one single bucket. But if you do this enough, you'll get similar items that are hashing to the same buckets. And so now, like, you can actually compare just within the bucket. And it's still Cartesian, but it's Cartesian for like 100 items or 1,000 items versus all 30,000. And in terms of like wall clock time, right, so you can do each bucket in parallel. So you spin up a big cluster, it can like crank these out. Okay. Tools. Yeah, so I showed Algebird, I showed Countman Sketch. We got Redis in there doing HyperLogLog, of course, Spark. So here's, this is the base monoid trait. Let's see. Yeah, so these monoids, parallel, associative, composable, that's the key. It's got BloomFilters. Yes, so I've actually implemented all these as part of the advanced Spark stuff. You can go in there and see examples. Min, max, average. It's a cool way of like looking at these types of problems. So of course, monoid, this is my favorite comment. It says, monoid, take a deep breath. Yeah, like don't freak out about the weird name. Yeah, just roll with us. So Redis has HyperLogLog, I showed that. That's the count distinct. This is out of the box, which I think it's using, is it using 12 bits or 14 bits? So it's using 14 bits because it's the 0.81% error. And then this is the API. And then, yes, I showed Jedis, which is a Java library for Redis. It's pretty cool. There's also something called, I think it's like WebDIS or something, where it's a REST API. Yeah, so that comes in handy. So what you do is, this is the movie, and then we'll add multiple users. And so these are all composable as well. So we could just keep, right, like adding like more and more users to that particular HyperLogLog. And then we call count, so this is the retrieve side, and that's gonna return just the distinct one. So it'd be 1, 2, 3, 4. Yeah, that one's overlapping. And then you can merge these as well. Yes, you can merge multiple. So yes, I showed right, like hour one, hour two, right, like trying to roll those up. So in terms of Spark, you probably have seen some of these, right? Like, have you guys seen these on the base RDD class? The counts approximate. Yes, anything with a prox obviously is using some sort of data structure, right? Like probabilistic data structure. So there's HyperLogLog Plus has crept in as an aggregator within Spark SQL. Stratified sampling, right? So trying to pull out sort of an even, right, like distribution. If you have way more males than females, right? Like you don't want to oversample on the male side kind of stuff. So by key, that's the key, is if you're gonna do it by gender. There's this thing called DIMSUM sampling. I've referenced this in the past. The method is row matrix column similarities, and it's doing probabilistic sampling. So essentially, any column that is more likely to show up, so basically has less non-zero, it has more more non-zeros, sample those less, because right, they're gonna just naturally end up in like more trials. So this way, what, like the whole basis of these things is to try to reduce this all pairs comparison, right? And then shuffle and all that stuff. So if we can just eliminate, right, like entire sections of data, this is good. And then this popped up in Spark 1.6, right? So anyone actually use this? It's Spark Streaming, it's a built-in A-B test framework. I have it, and there's these test methods that you can set. I still haven't tried this out, but and I have no idea where it came from because I don't remember it being on a roadmap anywhere, but someone must have submitted the pull request and it got accepted. So it's ways to start to insert like A-B tests into your streams. All right, so demo. I think I'll just cut to the actual notebook. So one thing to point out is, if I was gonna use just a regular hash set, this is the kind of memory, right? We'd have almost 7 megs of, so this is just a big range of like 100,000 numbers. So storing that in a naive way, yeah, this is actually a really cool tool. So there's a meetup organizer in Bangalore who basically went into the old Spark code that used to estimate shuffle and the size of like data structures and things like that, because pre-tungsten, it was all estimates, right? Like they didn't know exactly how big these hash maps were gonna be and that kind of stuff, right? When you're like pulling data from the mappers to the reducers. So in order to know when to spill, there was this super complicated code where it's going into every single object and sort of estimating, and you know, yeah, like may or may not be there. Since then, now it's all tungsten, now it's all byte arrays, now you can get the exact count. But yeah, he went in and created this little sort of like helper class that I pulled in. So we can get, so that's the estimate there for just a big fat hash set. And then this is HyperLogLog, so this is count distinct. Creating 14, yeah. So this is where you pass in the bits for the size of the range. And then this is the same size estimator class, but on the like HyperLogLog version of that same set. So it's coming in at, yeah, that's 7 megs, and that's 16K, which is pretty good. And like you can keep adding like values here, and that, yeah, that stays 16K. This is count min sketch, same thing. So that size is the same because it's the same hash set. Now we've got count min sketch size is 300,000 bytes. So here's an example. This is the Cartesian thing I was talking about, where you're doing that all pairs comparison of every every movie to every other movie, based on genre. So this is the worst thing, like you never want to see this in your code, Cartesian, but that's the naive way. Let's see, just doing a count there. So that's how many I would have to compare. And then this is, I built this little utility called similarity, get Jacquard similarity, threshold, where is this here? I might have pasted the wrong one in there. But essentially, yeah, so this whole Cartesian thing took 90 minutes versus the locality sensitive hashing version, which took like 5 minutes. It was like night and day. But that version broke right before, so I don't actually have the screenshot of that, but I still have this screenshot. So yeah, that's it. Big thing about probabilistic data structures. Yes, I'm curious, anyone actually use TensorFlow? This is like my next new thing, yeah. Right, like what do you think of it? Yeah, you. Thumbs up, right. Yeah, I finally got a GPU instance, a software instance, and I got this set up. I don't think it started though right now, but yeah, TensorFlow. And then so there was just a really good Databricks blog post that was TensorFlow and Spark working together, basically using Spark to pull the data in. And then parallel, right, because TensorFlow is just a Python library, right? So you can like take sections of it and then work on it on each like partition and then gather all the data back. So yeah, check out TensorFlow, it's cool. Yes, any questions? Cool, yeah. Oh, is it? Okay. Yeah, they didn't mention that part. Yeah.
So this wasn't in your slides. I just wonder if you've done any approximate set overlap.
See
things about that.
So I mean, it's basically what, like the intersection of two sets,
yeah.
Just the intersection without. So it's like the in the. Yes, are you doing that? Are you trying to do it?
Yeah,
it seems like a pretty normal.
I wish I could approximate it.
Yeah, yeah, I don't know. Yeah, that seems like a common use case. Yeah, very common. Yes, anyone else? Okay. Thanks. Yeah, this is so weird. My last talk was 3.5 hours, I think, and then, yeah, this one was 30 minutes. Boom! Getting better.